Welcome back to True Believers and the Road to Hell. We're here with Marty Pinales. So let's talk about training for a moment and how that has changed. I remember in Houston many years ago, it used to be we just had a day full of lectures. It seemed like people would lecture on this or that topic, you know, and the audience would clap and then go back home until we finally started the actual in practice.
Yeah, I think that the training is far better in trial skills, and it's a more of a hands-on type thing. And the National College of Criminal Defense, where we both got started, evolved into a course that was totally small groups, hands-on, with experienced trial lawyers, that the group would stay the same, groups of eight, but the instructors would rotate. And so that they would have the advantage of different instructors. They'd have 14 different instructors over the period of time that they were in. And they had the lectures of what to do. And then breaking down into small groups, trying it, failing sometimes, correcting it. And it's far better to do that in a simulated type trial at a training session than in a real courtroom with a real client as the being experimented on.
Right.
I remember when I graduated law school, was sworn in on a Saturday afternoon. I was working for a criminal defense lawyer, and he called me and said, "Okay, I want you to handle this matter in juvenile court." And I said, "Great, where's juvenile court?" And that was the very first case I had as a trial lawyer without any training at all.
I think I can one-up you on this one, Marty. That's a good story. But the first jury trial I ever had was January 4th of the next year, which when my boss and supervisor from the public defender office resigned December 31st of the previous year, 4 days earlier. And so I had a first-degree murder trial on that I was supposed to do with another guy who had the same amount of experience I did, which was zero. So we went in and fought like hell and had a pretty good result, but there's just no telling how ineffective, you know. I mean, anyway, we were lucky. I guess I say, yeah, my guy's eligible for parole next week or something, you know, 40 years later. But I'm kidding. Anyway, no, that's how it used to be, and that training has, I agree wholeheartedly, it's dramatically improved over the years, and lawyers are the ones who want to do it are much better trained than they used to be with this on the job training.
Well, I think that NCDC did that and set a standard so that there were copycat programs localized all over the country that followed the same procedure, hands-on, do it, redo it, do it this way instead. And that has set totally a higher standard for all criminal defense lawyers.
Well, I think the other programs have to be given some credit as well. The NIDA programs, of course, yeah. Those were largely a lot of civil lawyers, but the NIDA program kind of started with their formula, you know, that as well, and other programs. But whatever program you're dealing with, whoever's listening, in-person training of when your client's not actually going to jail is much better than practicing on the back of your client. So let me ask you another couple of things. I'll let you go, but I'm wondering about the difference. We've touched on we touched on gender issues earlier, and we know it, you were talking about it in terms of having different communication, different points of view on juries, for example. But it's also been different in the profession, hasn't it? I mean, you've had many more, as you pointed out, you have many more female attorneys these days, and as you pointed out, many more female graduates of law school these days. And I think racial diversity has also been greatly expanded and improved. And our society has changed. It's not just, I don't know, let me just go back and confess that back when I was a young lawyer, it was all old white guys drinking a lot. You know, so there was a lot of alcohol involved. There weren't many people of color, and there weren't many women involved. So I'm just giving you a platform to take off on here in terms of the improvements and how that has affected things over the years, and what your view of it is.
Well, it also goes back to some of the other topics that we touched upon, and that is that we are dealing with not a statistic, a case number. We are dealing with human beings. And with the diversity on the bench, it lets that diversity that has had different life experiences deal with the people that are coming before the court with a better understanding of where these people are coming from and sometimes what they're doing and how they're doing. And it's interesting to see. Now, when I started practicing, we did have some African-American judges. Few and far between, but we had a few. Now it is more representative of our society. We have female judges. We have probably an equal amount of female to male judges. In the areas that I practice. In our federal court, it's still very male dominated, but we have many, many, many more female judges creeping into the system, intentionally or unintentionally. They're coming in and they are bringing a different whole attitude of the judicial system into being. And I think it's for the better. I think it's for the better because a judge shouldn't be there just to judge people that are like that judge. That judge should be there to judge all people.
I don't think there's any question it's for the better. I think that the only, I hear, well, I'm what I have in my mind right now is Ron DeSantis, you know, who's talking about Florida being where woke goes to die and this kind of thing, you know, and there is a backlash, and there's a political backlash to diversity, what as I see it, and which I find kind of strange. But what do you think about the I suppose that, I guess there's a point, is, you know, there is a point where wokeism goes too far, I suppose, but in the judicial system, I don't think you see it very much. What's your view of that backlash?
Well, we had, instead of a backlash in Cincinnati area, we had a federal challenge where they set out divisions of our courts so that it was possible and probable that in one division, which covered a certain geographic area of the city, a Black judge would be and could be elected. And there was some pushback at the time. It has worked perfectly and is totally accepted. Now, there is backlash in this country about everything. If somebody says it's a beautiful day, there'll be somebody that's ready to fight and say, no, it's a miserable day. And we are such a divided nation in politics, in lifestyle, in social, in economic benefits. I think that hopefully it doesn't hit the court system.
Do you think it has not?
It started, but not like the general society. The court has been, at least in this area, a real pushback against it. Now, in the state of Ohio, we have elected judges.
As we do too.
In our federal system, of course, we have appointed judges.
Which do you prefer?
Which do I prefer? At one point, I preferred the federal system because I thought that they were absolutely resistant to public opinion. They were just there to do the right thing. That is no longer in the case now. I think that
why is that not the case anymore? Is that because of your perspective changed or theirs?
Probably both. That's a good question. Probably both. But I think federal judges are now selected. While it's the same selection process, the motivation behind the selection has totally changed.
Much more sophisticated.
A person doesn't get there unless they have a political view. When before in Congress, when the Senate Judiciary Committee would start to question the judge about how do you feel about this and how do you feel about that, they would say, I don't feel one way or the other. And if I did, I can't and won't talk about it because as a judge, I shouldn't even consider that. Now, you don't get to that point unless you have a certain philosophy. And that's what's going on in our Supreme Court right today.
Well, you know, I think that you're absolutely right. But I would think that that's a catastrophe waiting to happen because of that. I mean, I don't know. I'm pretty gloomy about that. How do you feel in terms of, you know, if you have, for example, you have Trump judges or you have Biden judges, you have judges who have certain views on abortion or have certain views on guns or this or that, and the process for selecting judges is so much more sophisticated now than it used to be in terms of going out and finding every detail about their life and having them being vetted by one interest group or another is what you're suggesting, I think. I mean, don't you think that a system can't sustain itself, a democratic system can't sustain itself if it has partisans?
It's like a pendulum that swings. And unfortunately, we are at a bad swing in that pendulum. I'm an optimist, and I hope that system is going to swing back. That pendulum is going to swing back.
Well, I'm perhaps less optimistic than you, but I think I would at least think that the pendulum swinging is necessary. It must swing back in order for the system to survive.
But, you know, you raise an interesting point. And looking at our federal bench here in Ohio, we have Biden, Clinton, Trump, and Bush appointed judges. And we have some absolutely great judges. And oftentimes, I even have to look at who appointed them to see. You can't tell from their philosophy or opinions or decisions. And our federal bench seems to take that position extremely seriously. And we have some Federalist Trump-appointed judges that are some of the best judges we have, because they are able to put aside that.
That's very good. That's very heartening to hear, because I hadn't heard that a lot. I mean, when I saw this Texas judge in Amarillo ruling on the abortion drug, mifepristone or whatever it's called, that seemed to be, you know, a problem.
Well, the problem is not the judge. The problem is that in Amarillo, there is one judge. And the case was brought in Amarillo because there is one judge with that philosophy.
Right.
So the problem with the system is not, well, it may be that judge, but it is not just that judge. It's the way you can pick and choose a jurisdiction to bring that kind of case.
Right.
They cherry picked that jurisdiction.
Okay. I don't know that the point is any different because of it, but that's right. It's kind of analogous to gerrymandering in a way that causes problems as well. But so let me ask you, Marty, what do you think is the biggest public misperception about how the system works?
Oh, I've had clients come into my office and they said, okay, you're friends with the judge? I said, I know the judge. Can you give him a little money? Can you make this case go my way if I pay you a little more? And there's a bonus for you and maybe a bonus for the judge. There's an awful lot of TV and movie thought processes that go into our judicial thinking of what we think of the judicial process. And I can tell you, I've only been in practice 52 years. I can tell you, I have never seen a judge take a bribe ever in my entire state or federal. But I think people think it happens all the time.
Well, just perception is reality in a sense, right? And perception is the problem sometimes. If the public perceives the judiciary as corrupt, whether it's for bribes or for some other, you know, motivation, that in itself is a problem regardless of the reality.
Let me give you a little antidote on that. When I was teaching in Myanmar, I'm teaching with public defenders, and we're talking, and they say, hey, when we get a result, we always give the judge a little money. We always pay off the judge. I said, well, that's terrible. They said, well, wait a minute. If you go into a restaurant and you get good service, don't you give the person who's serving you a little extra money? I said, yeah, but that's not the judicial system. And they say, well, wait a minute. Do you not give judges any money at all? And I said, well, not federal, but judges, as I said, in Ohio, run for election. And in order to run for an election, they have to do a campaign. And the Supreme Court of Ohio says it's perfectly proper and, in fact, encouraged for lawyers to give money to the judge to run a campaign. And they looked at me and they said, does the judge know who gave the money? And I said, yeah. They said, well, what's the difference in what we just said? And I had to lean back and say, you know, you're right, I'm wrong.
No, absolutely. Well, there's no way around it, but though they do have rules in New Mexico anyway for not disclosing where the money comes from, supposedly, but elected judges know who supports them and who doesn't. That's
absolutely,
that's for sure.
So
that's
in Ohio, they pick up the phone, the judicial candidate picks up the phone and says, you know, I'm running for office. you know, I have this campaign coming up. I'm not allowed to ask you for money. So here's my campaign chairman. And they hand the phone to the campaign chairman. And then they get your pledge right there. So it's not the judge that's asking for the money. But come on, they're standing right next to him.
That's really an argument for not having elected judges, isn't it? But yeah. It's been a conundrum that you and I've lived with for decades in terms of how do you best select judges. Do you have any wisdom on that, on what would be a better system?
Well, I used to think the federal system was better, but politics have now really gotten into the selection of judges in the federal system. So I have no advice at all. I am as lost as everybody.
Let me ask you about one other subject. It's not really related, but I wanted to ask you at some point, we'll tag it in here somehow, and that is, I'm wondering if there was any similarity in your international teaching, if there was any similarity to grand juries, or what, I guess the ultimate question is what you think of the grand jury, because I have my own strong opinions about it, and I'm wondering what you think.
Well, you know, the grand jury itself was enacted under the British system of having a body of citizens come between the crown and the regular people. And that system now brings together a group of people that generally know nothing about the law. It is a secret session. I served on our state grand jury at one point. I was subpoenaed and didn't exercise my right to get off as a lawyer. And I sat there for 3 weeks. And there was a retired Cincinnati homicide detective that was also on our panel of grand jurors. And he was tougher on the cases than I was even. And the prosecutor would present evidence, always one-sided. You know, they say a bad prosecutor can indict a ham sandwich. Right. And it's so true, because these people will believe whatever the prosecuting attorney tells them is the law. And they follow the law. And unless there is an antagonist somewhere along the line, they will indict, period. So it's somewhat of a useless body of people now that has long passed the doctrine of a group between the king and the people.
Well, you're just parroting every word I would say.
Same thing. But it was exciting. It was exciting because the prosecutor would return no bills, and the prosecutor would come in and say, why did you do that? I said, because the case is going to be thrown out later anyway.
Yeah, well, I think the grand jury, we could probably talk for a long time about it, but it seems to me to be an anachronism and a waste of taxpayer money, probably.
But, yes.
So let me ask you one other thing, and I'll let you go, which is, what are you going to do from here?
Well, my wife and I were talking about it just this past weekend, and I think I'm going to continue to practice. I'm going to do more pro bono than I like to do.
What is your wife's name?
My wife is Anne, and she is, we're coming up in August to our 58th year of marriage.
Wow.
And she has wings. I can only tell you in a halo, she'd have to be married to me. And she knows when I'm in trial, and my kids knew it when they were growing up and in the house. When I'm in trial and in a trial mode, just give me room and give me space to work on my case. And I think I'm probably going to cut down to maybe 4 days a week.
You probably ought to cut more. Well, I'll leave it to you. But
I think I'm going to take a longer weekend and can visit grandkids and colleges and things like that.
I think you said off the record here that you have 7 grandchildren.
I have 7 grandchildren, but part of that is that my son had triplets. So that brought the skew up very quickly. One of those triplets, interestingly, is going to start law school this fall.
That's incredible. And congratulations. That's amazing. But I wonder, it raises a kind of a serious question, which is something I've noticed anyway, that generations and experience and age really does matter. I used to think it didn't. I wonder if you see you being treated differently for better and worse the older you get.
One of the things that is great about the profession of law is that the older I get, it seems I get a little more respect in the courtroom. And especially when I am up in front of a judge that still has acne, they are younger, and some of them I trained. I was in front of an appellate judge a couple of weeks ago who was at NCDC in Macon, and when she was a public defender. And, I find that I am listened to more. I have a bigger responsibility because I've been on so many activities with the Bar Association and all involved in the community as a lawyer, that it has earned some respect, rightfully or wrongfully.
Well, as we said earlier, there's advantages and disadvantages to everything, right? So sometimes you get more respect than you do, maybe because you've been around a while. On the other hand, I think there is an ageism component in our society also, right? Where you are not called upon because of your age at sometimes, which, you know, rightly or wrongly, a younger point of view is sought out.
Well, I agree, but in the courtroom itself, I think age is
that's old. Where you get more. It's an advantage to you, you think?
Yes, I think so.
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, Marty,
or maybe just my ego saying.
Well, yeah, that could happen too. That could be a factor. Well, it's been a pleasure, Marty. And if you have anything else you'd like to talk about, you let me know. But
it's been a pleasure sitting here chatting with you. As I said, we go back a very long time teaching. And I find that when you teach with somebody and you spend a full week together, it is a camaraderie that comes about that doesn't come when I see you at a meeting. Everybody's in a hurry to go to a dinner. And so we would just sit around and just talk. And it was nice to get to know people like you in a better way. And that's what we have to do with the legal profession.
Right. Well, the legal profession today, I think you would agree that in courtrooms across the country, they rely on technology so much that they are eliminating the humanity out of the system. You have TV screens or computer monitors, I should say, and podiums and tables and all kinds of different equipment.
And COVID didn't help that situation. Right.
So it becomes less and less personal. So yes, We'll work on that. You and I will work a little bit on improving that. So thank you, Marty, and good luck to you and your and Anne and your grandkids and so
thank
forth.
Thank you. Thank you.
And keep up that good fight.
Thank you.
So that'll be this segment of True Believers and the Road to Hell.